Thank you very much for inviting me to talk today. And yes, it is an extremely broad topic. I'm going to touch on a few little things. I'm really here to talk more about one of our developing citizen science programs, which I'll talk about towards the end of the talk. So I'm the manager of the Networks and Partnerships unit within Threatened Species Operations. So Maggie sits within the same branch, Wildlife and Threatened Species Operations. There's a Northern and Southern Wildlife unit. They look after what we consider human conflict species like koalas, crocodiles, cassowaries, flying foxes, whereas we look after all the others. And I should say that at the moment in Queensland, there are currently 1,049 threatened species. That number is going to go up very shortly by a considerable amount. Yes. So before we go on, I just want to acknowledge the traditional owners of the land upon which we meet today, the Cubby Cubby people, and acknowledge their leaders past, present and future. And also, I want to acknowledge the very long and continuing deep association they have with land and sea country and the plants and animals that exist there. So the first thing I'm going to talk about is give you an extremely brief overview of the Threatened Species Program 2020-2040. So this is a departmental program, and it underpins everything that we do in terms of threatened species recovery. I just want to highlight a couple of things from the program, and one is the vision statement that you can see there. And that's about Queenslanders supporting threatened species. Now, that in itself means that all of us, all Queenslanders, can become involved in supporting threatened species recovery and persistence. The other thing that I just wanted to highlight were those three goals of the program. So it's about persistence, about recovery, it's about protection from changing environments, and it's also raising awareness of Queenslanders about threatened species. There is, if you Google Threatened Species, Queensland Threatened Species Program 2020-2040, you'll see a document that summarises it, give you a lot more information. And I should say right from the start that I'm a botanist. And so I'm here to advocate for some of those things that tend to get ignored behind the things that have got big eyes and long eyelashes. And I'm not saying for a second that those things aren't deserving of threatened status or any of the work that goes into it. So we're very keen to harness the potential around citizen science for a number of reasons. And they're around helping us monitor threatened species, population trends, etc., filling knowledge gaps. And obviously, as Fiona Fraser alluded to earlier, that can help us with developing recovery action plans or other documents that set out what recovery actions are required. It can provide us with data that we can use to develop population trajectories and publicly make those available. And obviously, well-designed citizen science programs help us to expand our capacity. Even though we have received additional funding from the Queensland Government recently, we will never have enough people or enough funds. And so, given that we've got 1,049 threatened species, that's a lot of work. We're also working at the moment on a number of different things in the background with which we intend to support citizen science groups under our new citizen science program, which is called the Queensland Threatened Plant Network. So there are going to be documents available to help guide organisations in developing recovery planning documents, how to set up recovery teams, etc., etc. We're working very closely with our federal counterparts in making sure what we're doing aligns with what they are doing at the federal level as well. So I want to just talk briefly about probably our most successful, certainly our longest running citizen science program in Queensland, and that is around monitoring nesting marine turtles. So this program's been going for 56 years now, which is pretty incredible when you think about it. We're actually now into turtle nesting season. You're probably all aware of places like Monrepo, where a lot of this work happens. And there we have about 15 volunteers a day engaged in actually data collection, monitoring nests, etc. But there are a number of offshore islands where turtle nesting occurs, and we also have volunteers that go out to those islands and monitor turtle nesting success, predation, the whole works. And there's a number of national parks as well, places like Deepwater National Park, just south of Agnes Water, where it occurs. So they collect various data, numbers of nesting females, the numbers of hatchlings that are produced out of different nests, etc., etc. So now I'm going to talk more about the Queensland Threatened Plant Network that we're currently developing. And, you know, one of my roles is to try and raise awareness of threatened species. So the picture up there is a thing called Antrophyllum ostrica queenslandicum, which commonly is known as the Water Ranger's Lion Fern. That is a thing that is critically endangered. We actually had a collaborative project on it last year through federal funding. When we started that project, we knew of 47 individuals of that species. Now, this is something that doesn't have beautiful flowers, it doesn't have a fragrance, it's about that high, full adult size. You know, somebody's got to love these things, and but I'm just trying to illustrate to you that threatened species cover an enormous range of things. When you've got something like this, we still don't understand a lot of this species' ecology. It only occurs on andesite boulders, and you can have two andesite boulders side by side. One will have ferns on it and the other won't, and we have no idea why that happens at this stage. So we've developed a collaborative agreement with the Australian Network for Plant Conservation, and through that agreement we have funded them to employ a project manager for the project who works very closely with myself. Paul Donachew, who isn't here, is the project manager, and he's helping develop some of this background documentation, foundational stuff that we're doing at the moment. And really the network is around facilitating the forming of partnerships, whether they're formal or informal, amongst the various different groups that we envisage will be members of the network. And so those groups are people like First Nations group, Land and Sea Rangers groups, NGOs, community-based conservation organisations, like organisations like Native Plants Queensland, etc., etc. And ultimately the goal is to improve the coordination of threatened plant recovery in Queensland. We know that there is a lot of work going on out there, but there is a lot of work that a lot of people don't know about. And so one of the jobs on my list to do this financial year is to develop a database to capture all the threatened plant projects that are happening across the state by anybody. That's both research and on-ground recovery stuff. I've got another job to develop a threatened plant monitoring system as well, which has ties to the network. And we want to make sure that we get all of our ducks lined up really properly before we go public, so to speak, make an announcement and launch it. Because we realise that if we lay the foundations properly, then it has a much better chance of success in the long term. And we want to set this up as an enduring program. We only have funding for a limited period of time at any one point of time, and you know, it's one of the vagaries of working for government. But we want to try and set this up so it endures beyond any funding that we may be able to provide. And that's why we entered into a partnership with the Australian Network for Plant Conservation. So some of this stuff I've probably already spoken a little bit about, but you know, we are developing documents around establishing recovery teams. And again, like I said, we're working very closely with our federal counterparts to make sure we align with what they are doing. So we're working on a system, and we hope and expect expect that some members of the network will start forming recovery teams, and we will be providing some guidelines to help them do that and some support. We'll be providing some templates, etc., to help people along as well. Next calendar year, there will be some competitive grants around for recovery action projects for threatened species in Queensland. There's about $1 million in that bucket. We also have just recently started an Indigenous identified person in my unit who's going to be working with land and sea ranger groups around threatened species recovery. We have about another $900,000 in that bucket to fund land and sea ranger groups as well. So we're very keen to harness the potential in citizen science, and I think Fiona Fraser outlined what the benefits are around that earlier on. But we've got a number of challenges. They are things like regulatory challenges. So under the plant regulations in Queensland, the Nature Conservation Act, it is basically impossible to authorise a community organisation to do things that are valid recovery actions, like, for example, collect property of material and grow that on, do some ex situ work, do some supplementary wild planning, stuff like that. So we're working through that at the moment. Obviously, data is very important. We need to make sure that we're setting up proper standards for data stuff. We know of a number of organisations that are already interested in joining the network, but we're really keen to hear from anybody that's got any tips about how we set up the program to endure so that it lasts for as long as possible. And, you know, again, I've spoken about this support, what happens after the bucket runs dry for us. And we are seeking help from anybody at all that's got any good ideas around that. Oh, before I go, I should talk, because I've got a couple of minutes or two. I just want to highlight that picture. It's Eucalyptus delvenica. That's another critically endangered species that does not occur anywhere on a protected area. It only occurs on private property up in the Granite Belt. Again, we know of about 387 individuals of that species. And so when you're talking about those sort of numbers, you're getting pretty close to the cliff. But we do have, we are writing internally some recovery action plans, we call them, for some threatened species. This is one of them. We are writing one for the Border Rangers Lion Fern at the moment as well. So yeah, there's a number of things happening in that space. Thank you very much.
Okay, you've allowed plenty of time for questions, John. So,
and look, I know that was a really broad brush, brief view, but yeah, happy to answer any questions, except the difficult ones.
You got a hard question? Nice hard question, that'll do, thanks. Yeah, sorry.
It was about releasing threatened species data and how that can be an issue.
Yeah, so releasing it, obviously, critically endangered don't necessarily want to release it, but then you put barriers towards citizens engaging with that sort of science and searching. Just wondering if you've considered that and what aspects, how are you trying to manage around that?
We certainly have considered that. You know, there are unfortunately still a lot of, there's still a lot of poaching that occurs. Like I know of Phaeus australis, one of the ground orchids that threatened nearby national parks. We know it's still being poached out of national parks, despite the fact you can buy it in a nursery for $30. So it's always going to be a challenge. I think the key to that is to make sure that people understand that the data, if the data falls in the wrong hands, it can be very detrimental. I mean, years ago when I was a ranger in charge in Bundaberg, we actually did the local president of the Bird Watchers Association, because he used to use their trips to do, as spotting trips. He would then go and collect the eggs, play the eggs. He was an egg collector. So, you know, it can happen. and it can happen from people that you wouldn't expect. So it is a challenge, but I mean, we do release threatened species data. If somebody's doing a research project or a conservation project and they request the release of confidential data from WildNet, then our unit actually authorises that. Like, we look at it, you know, yes, somebody's intending to do genuine research with that data, then yeah, they can have the data. It is a fine line.
Up the back there, just
yes.
Please use a microphone.
Hello. Hi, John. It's not a hard question. Well, it might be. Your database of threatened species plant projects that you're working on, will that include threatened fauna or now or later at all?
Fauna?
Yeah.
At this stage, it's not intended to be threatened fauna. But that's not to say that at some point in the future it won't be expanded. I mean, of the 1,049 threatened species in Queensland, 792 of them are plants. So, you know, what's that, about two-thirds of all threatened species in Queensland are plants. So, yeah, we've probably got enough to work with that for a start. And, you know, there's things like what's happening in koala space. Obviously, some of the fauna stuff. You know, northern hairy-nosed wombats, we basically know every hairy-nosed wombat by on a first-name basis. So for some threatened species, we have a wealth of information, whereas for others, we have much less.
Yes.
We are working, so my unit is working at the moment on with CSIRO through a contract arrangement to develop a threatened species prioritisation decision support tool, which will be available for public use around the middle of next calendar year. And that's a big job, which entails a huge database, as you can imagine. The decision support tool will not give you a ranked list of X number of threatened species. You'll interrogate the database through a portal. You'll give it parameters like geographic area, you know, what taxonomic level you want to work at, family, whatever. What species are the most cost-effective to recover based on your parameters, co-map, all that sort of stuff. It will then throw back at you a group of species. And any prioritisation system, there, you can't use it as a black box and just take the results that it spits out as face value. There needs to be some more human moderation around that. And it all depends on person, organisation's situation that may not be accounted for in the parameters. So, for example, if I'm an organisation somewhere that wants to work on threatened frogs in a particular area, and I might have $50,000 that I can invest in that, in the recovery. So, out of that group that I get after interrogating the database, it might tell me this species is going to cost $150,000 to recover, for argument's sake. This one's going to cost $50,000. So you might go, okay, I've only got 50,000, that's the one I'm going to do. So that's the sort of why it's meant to be used.
Okay, thanks, John. That's terrific. Okay.
Thank you very much.